Hello and welcome to today's episode of pianoTV. I'm Allysia, your host, and today we are going to look at 24 fascinating facts on the virtuosic rock star performer Franz Liszt. We've also done a brief history video on Franz Liszt, and that gets into more of the details of his life and so on, whereas this is just more of like a kind of, it covers some of the same ground, but I just find it a little more fun, easy to follow, lighthearted, if you're not wanting to get like deep into the history. So if you're interested in Liszt and what all the fuss is about, definitely keep watching. Let's get started. Number one, Liszt's father. He was the reason that Franz Liszt got into music in the first place. Liszt's father, Adam, was a musician in his own right, and he knew musical giants such as Haydn and Beethoven. He actually worked at the Esterházy estate, which was the same place that Haydn spent many, many years of his life as a musician. Young Liszt would listen to his father play the piano, and then his father ended up giving him lessons in playing and compositions from the time he was a young boy. Liszt's father was very strict with him for practicing with a metronome, and that might be one reason why Franz Liszt is known for having excellent absolute tempo. He was also known to be an excellent sight reader, and I mean, honestly, are you really surprised? In addition to his father knowing some of the classical greats, Liszt himself took piano lessons from Carl Czerny. Carl Czerny was a renowned teacher. He wrote a whole bunch of exercises and was a student of Beethoven. Liszt also took lessons from people such as Antonio Salieri of Mozart fame. Liszt spent many years of his life as a piano teacher, and he would often teach group lessons, favoring those over private lessons. When he first started, he worked morning to night with students scattered all across Paris, so he was often working very late into the night and traveling huge distances just to get from, you know, one student to the next. As a piano teacher, Liszt was less consumed with fixing technical details. He wanted his students to clean their dirty laundry at home. He was more concerned with the broader context and the artistic details of a performance. Liszt spent approximately a decade of his life touring across Europe relentlessly, often performing 3 to 4 times a week, which means in total he performed over 1,000 times in this time period. This was the time period where Listomania really began and took root, which is basically when people freaked out for Franz Liszt. Even after he retired from all of that relentless touring, I mean, he would still play shows and stuff, his reputation as one of the greatest piano performers of all time stayed with him throughout the rest of his life. Liszt was Elvis before Elvis was Elvis. They called it Listomania, and basically like women would faint and go into a frenzy when they would see him perform, so much so that local doctors actually postulated that it was some sort of mental illness epidemic. And it wasn't just women swooning over Franz Liszt, men were more or less in love with him as well. Upon seeing Liszt, one critic, Yuri Arnold, wrote, "As soon as I reached home, I pulled off my coat, flung myself on the sofa, and wept the bitterest, sweetest tears." Hans Christian Andersen wrote of Liszt, "When Liszt entered the saloon, it was as if an electric shock passed through it," he wrote in his diary after seeing Liszt perform for the first time. "It was as if a ray of sunlight passed over every face." Liszt basically created the solo piano recital. In the early 1800s, when Liszt was active, it was essentially unheard of for an individual musician to play an entire concert by themselves. But with playing so many performances, like thousands, Liszt didn't always have people to share the stage with, and so he would sometimes just play a recital all on his own. Now, he was popular enough that he was able to completely fill concert halls just being him, which revolutionized the way music performances went. He even moved where the piano was positioned on the stage so that people could see his hands while he performed, and so the sound would project more loudly in the hall. Liszt wasn't immediately famous and amazing, though. He was often criticized for his early compositional attempts when he was just getting into it when he was a young adult. When he saw Paganini perform on the violin in 1832, now Paganini was just a wildly amazing violin player. When Liszt saw him perform, it just set his soul on fire. He wanted to be what Paganini was to violin, to the piano, and he started working incredibly hard, and obviously we now know that he succeeded in his like virtuosic ambition. And that's a good segue for number 9, in that virtuosity didn't just like accidentally happen to Liszt. He really worked hard for it. After being inspired by Paganini, he wrote in a letter to a friend, "My mind and fingers are working like the damned Homer, the Bible, Plato, Locke, Byron, Hugo, Beethoven, Bach, Hummel, Mozart, Weber are all around me. I study them, meditate on them, devour them furiously. Furthermore, I practice for 4 or 5 hours a day. If only I don't go mad, you will find in me an artist." Because of his drive and ambition, Liszt built up an unparalleled technical prowess, so much so that he composed his transcendental etudes, some of the most difficult etudes in piano repertoire. If you want to learn more about those, you can see the video we did on the hardest Liszt music of all time, because several of those are featured. Robert Schumann claimed that only a few piano players in the entire world would be able to actually play these transcendental etudes. Liszt was such an intense piano player that he would often break strings when he performed. Now, granted, pianos in the 1800s weren't as powerful as pianos nowadays, but you have to give the guy credit for his just like raw energy and enthusiasm. In addition to being virtuosic and loud, Liszt also created a new genre called the symphonic poem. Now, the symphonic poem was basically an instrumental form of depicting a piece of art, whether it be actual fine art, whether it be literature or other such art forms. Sort of like an updated version of Baroque program music. Liszt had one long-term relationship, 40 plus years, with Princess Caroline Sayn Wittgenstein. The two of them never married, although they wanted to. Basically, Caroline's ex-husband was a big jerk and pretty much pulled some strings so that they couldn't actually get married. And he also took over her entire estate, left her with very little. The two had 3 children together, and it was actually because of her that Liszt decided to end his touring, crazy, hectic concert career. And because of this advice, because he hung up his hat after about a decade, he never became a washed-up musician. He ended up quitting touring at his prime so that people would always have like the highest, fondest memories of him. Liszt was known for being incredibly generous to friends and family, and even people he didn't even know, which we'll talk about in a moment. But he always had an ever-rotating ensemble of people at his house. The princess would often stay at his place. She pretty much lived there. Piano students who didn't have anywhere to go. Friends who maybe didn't have a place to stay because they were broke, such as Hector Berlioz at one point. In addition to these guests, Liszt's Weimar household also included a family cat named Madame Esmeralda and a loud guard dog named Rappo. By the 1850s, Liszt was making so much money from his concert performances that he donated virtually all of it to various charities. He donated to music programs like the Hungarian National School of Music. He helped fund the building of the Cologne Cathedral, a gymnasium at Dortmund, countless hospitals, schools, various causes, etc. In 1842, there was the Great Fire of Hamburg that left thousands of people homeless and a good chunk of the city in ruins. Liszt hosted a series of concerts specifically to raise money to help rebuild Hamburg. It's just one example, but Liszt was incredibly charitable. One Liszt biographer mentioned that he would often start a sentence when he was teaching by saying, "I'm no professor, but, you know, dot, dot, dot." Now, this just showed a general distaste for conservatories, and we can speculate as to why Liszt might not have been a fan of conservatories, possibly because of the focus on technical challenges as opposed to artistry. When Liszt was a young man, he fell in love with one of his students, but her father forbade the two ever get together. Liszt was so heartsick about this that he fell incredibly ill, like literally ill. So ill that there was an obituary notice printed about him in the Paris paper. This period of heartsickness inspired him to want to join the church, which was something that would be a recurring theme throughout his life, but his mother talked him out of it. Later on in Liszt's life, he went through some real trauma that inspired him to actually go out and get ordained, and his mother was no longer around to talk him out of it. In the 1860s, he lost 2 out of 3 of his children. He lost his 20-year-old son and his 26-year-old daughter, Blandine. And that just left him with one living daughter, Cosima. After these events, Liszt wrote to his friends that he would be living a solitary life in a monastery, and he went on to receive the 4 minor orders, which meant that he could be called Abbey Liszt. He never finished to become a priest, but he got close. Let's take a moment to marvel at Liszt's massive output on the piano. He composed over 1,000 pieces for the piano, most of those being original compositions and some of them being transcriptions of music by other musicians. Liszt's piano transcriptions are lesser known today, but they were a really big deal when he was alive. Since Liszt was so famous, if he were to create a piano arrangement of a lesser known or more obscure symphonic work, he was able to drive attention to that work and give the composer a nice boon in popularity. One example was Liszt's friend Hector Berlioz. Liszt wrote a piano transcription of Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique for piano solo, and he performed it frequently, and this really helped drive a lot of interest into Berlioz's music. And another composer he helped out in this way was Wagner, who had been exiled at the time, and the two of them would actually become really close friends. Wagner and Liszt became so close, in fact, that Liszt became Wagner's father-in-law. Wagner married Liszt's daughter. In addition to being very close friends until the end of Wagner's life, Wagner considered Liszt a top-rate musician, stating, "I feel thoroughly contemptible as a musician, whereas you, as I have now convinced myself, are the greatest musician of all times." Toward the end of Liszt's life, him and Debussy finally had a chance to meet. They had a piano party where they played music by each other and other composers. Liszt played one of Debussy's pieces from his years of pilgrimage, and he also played Schubert's Ave Maria on the piano. Debussy was really impressed. He described Liszt's pedaling like a form of breathing. Debussy performed with another musician, Vidal. They made a piano duet arrangement of Liszt's Faust Symphony. Apparently, Liszt fell asleep during that performance, but that's not to say it wasn't a good performance. It was more to say that Liszt was like a 75-year-old man at the time. Back to Liszt as a performer now. In addition to being wildly skilled and loud enough and bombastic enough to break piano strings, he also apparently made dramatic facial expressions and gestures when he was playing the piano. So much so that local newspapers would make comics about it. In his younger days, he also took some creative liberties with the compositions he was performing. For example, in Moonlight Sonata, he would add all these like fancy cadenzas and trills. That was just something that he did early on when he was in his heyday trying to impress everyone. Eventually, he scaled it back. Because that was one reason that him and Chopin ended up falling out of friendship for a while, because he just added too much fluffy stuff to one of Chopin's pieces of music and he was not impressed about it. Our final fact today is how Liszt is considered possibly the best piano player of all time, at least in his day. One music critic suggested that maybe Liszt was not the most transcendent virtuoso who ever lived, but his audiences thought he was. I hope you enjoyed this collection of facts about Franz Liszt. A lot of you are huge fans of Liszt and you comment about him a lot, as well as other Romantic era composers such as Chopin. And I have to agree, like, the thing that I like about Liszt is even though he might have been this like vain, flashy performer guy, he actually wasn't a vain personality. He seemed like he had a lot of depth, like spiritual depth, and he was incredibly generous and seemed like just a stand-up dude. Thank you so much for watching today's video. Give it a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe if you haven't already. Come visit me on social, and I'll see you in the next video. Liszt built up an unparalleled this period of heart Berlioz's symphony. I'm just gonna do that again.